The Ghanaians are saying that for a Nigerian trader to trade in that country, they need to pay a certain amount of money, and then some Nigerians have also weighed in on the matter. Some have also castigated the government for not doing enough to protect Nigerians in that country. But I'm joined live on the line this morning by Bashiru Dele Momodu. He's a Nigerian, but he has his businesses based in Ghana. He's a publisher of Ovation Magazine. He's a well-respected journalist right here in Nigeria. Thank you for joining us on Farm Talk this morning, Bashiru.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting me to speak on your popular program. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. So, you know, Nigerians know you. In fact, some people, you have sort of a dual nationality, a Ghanaian and a Nigerian. You have your businesses in Ghana. You relate very well with the politicians, even their president in that country. But we've been seeing some pictures, and you also share some of those videos over the weekend of the kind of treatment being meted out to Nigerian traders in Ghana. We don't have an understanding of it. Maybe you'd like to enlighten us, Bashiru, on what exactly is going on in Ghana regarding Nigerian traders.
Well, let me start by saying that I'm a proud Pan-Africanist, and I was largely influenced by the books of the Osagyefo, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. Growing up and reading a lot of African literature, I realized that we had some leaders who wanted Africa to unite. In fact, the title of one of Dr. Nkrumah's books is Africa Must Unite. So we had Dr. Nkrumah, we had, of course, the Nwalimu, Julius Nyerere from Tanzania, and a few of them like that. To cut a long story short, I discovered Ghana in 1995 on my way to exile in England. I passed through Ghana, and I instantly fell in love with the country. President John Jerry Rawlings was in power at the time. And I loved what I saw. There was no problem between Nigeria and Ghana. In fact, I felt very, very much at home. Unfortunately, I don't know what has happened. But by the time I came back to stay partly in Ghana and invested heavily in Ghana, President Kufuor was already in power. And the gentleman worked very hard to bring Nigeria and Ghana closer. In fact, before he left government, he made sure that one of the longest and one of the most important roads in Ghana was named after President Olusegun Obasanjo. He was the one who succeeded finally in bringing Nigerian banks to Ghana. The first bank was Standard Trust Bank, which now metamorphosed into the United Bank for Africa. And the Minister of Tourism worked very closely with Ovation to market Ghana to the world. You know, so yesterday I was looking at a picture of myself and President Kufuor when that work was being done. Their property business, today Nigerians have so much investment in property, in banking, and other institutions. Our students go to Ghanaian universities. They pay heavily. They are made to pay as foreign students. Now, the question is, what is the definition of ECOWAS? I thought it was meant to be, you know, freedom of movement of goods and people. But the videos I'm seeing out of Ghana, I'm not in Ghana at the moment, are very disturbing. And immediately I got those videos, I fired them to our Minister of Foreign Affairs, Mr. Jeffrey Onyema. And I've just seen his tweet. Just as I was about starting this interview, I saw his tweet where he said action will be taken urgently. Action must be taken speedily. There is no country that allows everybody like Nigeria. If anybody will treat any country, not Nigeria. I know what Nigeria has done in Ghana. Today, just imagine if you remove about 6 Nigerian banks out of the Ghanaian economy. It is not possible. Something will happen. If all the properties in Transako Valley, in Airport Residential, you know, in cantonment and all those places, if Nigerians decide that, okay, we are selling off and we are going. So you cannot like only the big investors and then you don't like the retailers. Because the problem now is with the retailers. The retailers, how do you ask a retailer? And what saddens me is that my own friend, young people who should educate the government and tell them that this is unfair. We have Nigerians and Ghanaians living in America. They live in Europe. If they give us such conditions, can we survive? A lot of them, a lot of Africans who live abroad, and that includes Nigerians and Ghanaians, don't even have their working papers. If the police comes and beats them up the way they were beating up our shop owners in Ghana, I'm sure the whole world will start a movement and say Black Lives Matter. So African lives don't matter. Now, Ghana is inviting those who were taken away as slaves. Last year, Ghana celebrated the year of the return. So when those blacks return, are they going to ask them to invest $1 million before they start a business? I know of so many, I employ Ghanaians, so I know what I'm saying. I employ Ghanaians both in Ghana and in Nigeria. Okay? And I know what I've paid their salaries in full since this COVID started. At a time, many companies are laying off workers. I've not been to Ghana. I don't need them right now. Maybe I need one. But I'm keeping them because they are human beings. They are our brothers. So we are sending a message across to Ghana that you cannot ill-treat Nigerians anyhow. There is no election that takes place in Ghana that candidates and everybody will not come to Buhari, come to our country. We support with everything in oil and gas. The West African gas pipeline, when we had problems here, it affected Ghana. The electricity went down. Okay? Obama just sent so many cars to support the Ghanaian police. The bulk of the hotels in Ghana today will be empty if Nigerians don't go to Ghana. We love Ghana. Ghana is one of the most peaceful countries in Africa. So I'm shocked and scandalized that today the people, the biggest spenders in Ghana, and the ones being treated in this manner. And we are appealing to the government authorities in Ghana and also appealing to our own government in Abuja that they must intervene urgently. There is no way you can have a petty trader to invest $1 million before you can trade in any country.
Okay, so, you know, Bashiru, this particular, treatment, this subsequent of event, I mean, judging by your explanation, we've had, you know, pretty good relationship with the Ghanaians for a long time. But is this a protectionist policy by the Ghanaian government, or is it a matter of jealousy or...
It is isolationist, it is protectionist, and we've had a heated debate on social media yesterday with our Ghanaian friends. There is no country that can ever make progress by saying only for my own people. Then don't go anywhere. Then tell the people to go back to their countries. In fact, if I were the leader of Nigeria today, what I would do immediately is to order all those people and make provisions for them. We're talking to a few state governments in Nigeria. Go and pull out your people. Instead of waiting till maybe things will get so bad and they will be killed. So get them out and come and settle them. Because how much can you make in any economy that you will invest $1 million? When we got there, they told us we had to invest $50,000. And I'm talking in the early days, maybe about 2002, 2003. They said we must invest $50,000. And that $50,000, when you transfer it, you must convert it into cedis. But then we're talking of a spare parts dealer. The thing is that there are people who push the government in Ghana. This is not the first time it's happening. But before we were able to resolve it, what they do is they think they can't compete with the Nigerians. You understand? It is about competition. Yeah, I will not use the word jealousy. It's about competition. And election is coming in December. So this is the best time that anyone can blackmail the government and say, no, you are not protecting us enough. You are allowing these Nigerians to take over our business. But it's the same way Ghanaians come to Nigeria. I'll give you just one example. When Governor Gbenga Daniels was the governor of Ogun State, A Ghanaian couple, I didn't know them, I never met them, called me frantically in Ghana and said they were demolishing illegal structures at Agbara Industrial Estate in Ogun State, and that all their investments they brought from Ghana was about to be demolished. I called the governor. I said, please, we must not discourage foreign investment. We are the ones always shouting foreign. The white man will come. He will not invest that $1 million. We'll be the ones begging them to invest. And you will not believe it. The governor hearkened to my advice and immediately ordered that these Ghanaians must not be touched. That they, in fact, they should go and check and see how they can make them feel welcome in Agbara. Why can't we do that, you know, for our own people in Ghana? If people commit illegalities, I will never support them. There are Nigerians who give us bad names. I will never condone them. But in this case, these are people with valid papers. Some of them registered their companies even before all these laws were made. You see, what they did was that suddenly one day, they moved the investment from $50,000 and went as high as $300,000. Who does that? All of our young men
are asking us to pay $1 million.
That you must invest $1 million before you can trade. How? Where? And I've asked my friends who are defending and trying to justify this nonsense that just mention one country where that is done. And now we're not talking of ECOWAS. And they are beating up people. I saw a man showing them his document. I pay my taxes. He was showing the document. The police said he should get up. The enforcement agency said he should get lost. They refused to look at the papers. That's what got me angry. I said, why? If you don't want them, simply tell them. It's a very skillful way of telling them to go back home. Trust me. Anybody who asks you to, how many companies in the world started with 1 million? I started Ovation with only £10,000 in London. And it was not mandatory. It was because that was what we could afford. Anywhere in the world, people encourage entrepreneurship. Any Nigerian living in Ghana, won't he pay bills? Is he making money free of charge? You know? So what do we mean by saying somebody should bring one? If they had $1 million, would they leave their country to travel abroad? When they were beating up Africans in South Africa, all of us were shouting. Now we are in West Africa. It's wrong. It's wrong. They say it's our law. Ask anybody now, they will say it's our law. What law? Law must have human face. I know the level of investment. If others don't know, I've been the chief promoter of Ghana in Nigeria. And that's why, in fact, a lot of people are telling me now that you see Tony. But I was encouraged by Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. I read all his books. I have all of them in my library here. So what is wrong with the black man? But the white man, you will not believe it. There was a time they were giving us problems in Ghana. And I belong to an association, the British Investors in Ghana. And then we went to our clubhouse for a meeting. And when I was telling them our ordeal, one white guy said, but me, I've been living in Ghana for 20 years and nobody has ever asked me questions. You will not believe it. White man. It's the same nonsense that make Africans to have to go and obtain visa to go to South Africa after everything that we did in South Africa. It's the same thing. But if I carry British passport, I will enter South Africa. I don't need visa. It's the same mindset. So I am speaking.
Are you satisfied with the response of the Nigerian government?
No, I am not. The Honorable Minister of Foreign Affairs is my friend and big brother. I call him Egbon, he calls me Aburo. I'm not. I've sent messages to him and I've sent to Honorable Abike Dabiri Erewa. Okay, but this is not under Abike Dabiri Erewa's purview, because this has to be done at the presidential level. As a matter of fact, I don't think it's the minister who should speak. The president should send a powerful message across to his colleague in Ghana and say, I will no longer condone. They demolished part of our High Commission's properties the other day, and they were giving excuses, cock and bull stories, offering apologies. You know, how do you cure cancer with Panadol? You understand? So the thing is that it's either you love me or you don't. People want us only to come as tourists. In West Africa, not as investors. Any country that tells you put down $1 million before you set up business, that country says don't come. I don't know why people are afraid to face reality. If a country does not want me, then I leave. I always tell my friends, I say, look, if your wallet is too much, you know they didn't chase me out of my country. I came here and invested my money. The money I invested there, if I invested it, I would have bought properties in Banana Island. But we thought, let's expand. After all, Coca-Cola is all over the world. So why can't we have Nigerian businesses all over the world? CNN is everywhere. So why can't we have Ovation International everywhere? That is what drove me to Ghana. And I'm telling you, Ghanaians are beautiful people. It's just a few people. Ghanaians are fantastic. I've traveled to every part. I probably know Ghana more than Nigeria. Up to Bogatanga, to Wa, that is the end of Ghana. I've been everywhere by road. Truck drivers, like our own downfall drivers, they all know me. Chivo. Ghanaians are fantastic people, but just a few traders. A few traders winding up their government. You know, nationalist things. Are we different from the white supremacists in America, if you can treat our own fellow Nigerians like this? I give kudos to the leaders of Ghana who built this rock-solid relationship with us. They know that all the investments they are looking for in America, in Asia, they can get between Lagos and Abuja. Go and look at what the Dangotes, the Adenugas are doing in Ghana. And then you will say you don't want the small traders, but you don't mind the big investors. No. Mm-hmm. No. Mm-hmm.
Well, so, you know, Bashiru, some have said, well, in international relations and international diplomacy, there is the policy of reciprocity. I mean, tit for tat. Judging by your own knowledge of the Nigerian Ghanaian business relationship, if we are to pay them back in their own coin, do we have that much Ghanaian investment in Nigeria at that level to reciprocate this their unfair gesture?
No. You see, I wouldn't even suggest that. I believe we're just going to injure innocent people. There are many fantastic Ghanaians working in Nigeria. There are too many Ghanaians married to Nigerians and Nigerians married to Ghanaians. If they understand, we should not allow politicians who are using politics to whip up raw sentiments and emotions to divide us. I will not touch the ordinary Ghanaians in Nigeria. Some people have been saying it on social media yesterday, let's go and beat them up. No, I will never support it. I will never support any. The measure, I know the things that can touch Ghana, and our presidency knows. They know what they can do that will not affect the ordinary Ghanaians, but will affect the government of Ghana. And they know the language in diplomacy. They know the language. There are things.
What would that be?
They are not things that I can discuss on open air. Do you understand? So there are all kinds of bilateral relationships between our countries. And those bilateral relationships guarantee that if either of us is misbehaving, there is something we can do about it. So, for example, I see no reason why Nigeria right now, if ECOWAS is not working, then get out of it. We are the biggest investors in all these continental and regional bodies. Nigeria forms a lot of these bodies. You understand? So if we say tomorrow that if you are going to treat any Nigerian in any part of West Africa, we're no longer part of ECOWAS. You will see what will happen. I'm telling you, you can see it even at the level of the African Development Bank. You can see the influence of Nigeria. Nigeria, forget about our local politics and local challenges. Nigeria is the superstar of the African world. Nobody can monkey with Nigeria. That one I'm very sure of. But if our leaders every time behave like we are timid, then people are. If your junior boy knows that he can slap you and get away with it, he will slap you repeatedly. You slap the right cheek, you turn the left cheek. Before you know it, they will turn you to Mugun. That's why it's happening, because we are always weak. When Obasanjo, God, please, nobody will try it with Baba Obasanjo. Nobody. Trust me. And I'm angry because I know how much I love Ghana. And I know the work we have done in Ghana. And I know the millions and millions of dollars that Nigerians have invested in Ghana. And I know that the ordinary Ghanaian loves Nigeria to bits. So it's not a relationship that we should allow politicians or those who have political motivations to destroy. Some people worked for it. I once brought President Jerry John Rawlings and his entire family to Nigeria. They flew with me. In fact, he told me, he said, Chief, what did you use that? I carried my entire family on a flight to Lagos. That's how the kind of relationship that we have built over time. President Kufuor, I met him 5 days after he became president at a public, at a party, an event, the 40th birthday of Alhaji Asuma Banda's wife, Mrs. Edwina Banda. Right inside there, I interviewed him. And as God will have it, we lived on the same road for years when he was president. He was living in his personal house, driving to office every day. And whenever we needed anything, all you have to do is call his house and he would invite you over. That relationship now is being destroyed. Trasaco Valley is one of the most prized real estates in Ghana. Nigerians invested. I can tell you how many Nigerians I took into that estate. I used to do marketing. When the Lapan Beach Royal Hotel was being built, you will not believe it. Ovation was the first to publicize it. The first year, they had 18% occupancy. Within a few years, the occupancy at that hotel was 55%. In fact, there are rumors that the part owners of Kempinski Gold Coast in Accra, which is the biggest hotel right now in Accra, it's partly owned by Nigerians. There are Nigerian investors there. I know the number. I mean, imagine Sahara Energy, how much they have done in Ghana. You know, so I don't know. I don't know who is pushing the government, but then the government would have to stop the police from beating up our people. I don't mind if they've committed crime, if they want to check their documents, that is easy. But they should stop beating up our people. It is uncomfortable.
Just before I let you go, sir, you know, isn't this sort of, you know, payback time for what we did to the Ghanaians ourselves in 1983?
No, it is not. It is not. There is nothing that Nigeria did. No, it is not. There is nothing that Nigeria did that Ghanaians did not do. Ghanaians chased Nigerians out of Ghana. Nigerians also did it. And that is in the past, and we should forget it. That has nothing to do with it. So a lot of people don't know the history. That's why they keep saying Nigerians chased them out. So nobody talks about when Nigerians were chased. That one we've put behind us. We have moved beyond that. We shouldn't destroy what we have built. And that is why I'm alarmed. And that's why I am telling my Ghanaian friends, my brothers and sisters, that speak up. Everybody is quiet. If it's America, we all talk. I am embarrassed that I know so many people in Ghana and everybody is afraid to speak up. And you know, this is election time, so nobody wants to, they don't know what would happen and everything. I believe the reason some people are stoking this fire is that they are blackmailing their government. You cannot allow Nigerians to take over our country. You know, Nigerians are the Americans of Africa. Everywhere we go, people feel threatened. Yes, of course, there are bad heads. If you have 200 million people and 10,000 of them are bad, it will affect the rest of the 200 million. You understand? But it doesn't mean that Nigeria has the sole rights of being bad or that we are the only bad people in the world. There are bad people everywhere. Every country has their own bad people. So my advice to both governments is that they must sit down urgently and make sure that all these obnoxious laws, I call them atrocious laws, must be wiped out urgently.
All right. Well, yeah. I'd like to appreciate you very sincerely, Bashir Odele Momodu, for joining us on Frank Talk this morning on Rave 91.7 FM. It's a pleasure having you on the show today, Chief.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Have a
nice week ahead. Thank you.
You too. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All right, Bashoru, Billy.